I'm Brian Pierce. I'm the director of the Information Innovation Office at DARPA. And what I like to do, I like to start by just saying a little about DARPA, since for some of you it may be a little mist of mystery, maybe. So DARPA is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency located in Washington, D.C. The D in DARPA keeps us focused on the mission of national security, while the P keeps us centered on the development of breakthrough technologies in support of this mission. Now, breakthrough to DARPA is assessing the current edge of the art throughout the world and then really striving to go 10 times beyond it. That's our goal anyway. DARPA is not a general R&D organization doing open-ended discovery. We are project-focused. We are approximately 100 program managers with a diversity of scientific and technical backgrounds. We come from companies, universities, other parts of the government, stay at DARPA for 4 to 5 years to start and manage programs with revolutionary impact, we hope, and then move on to opportunities outside and inside the government. Now, this 20-25% annual turnover rate in program managers actually is very fundamental to DARPA's success in pursuing new ideas. DARPA has no labs and little infrastructure to support, and so the bulk of its $3 billion annual budget goes outside the agency in the form of R&D programs and contracts. The average duration of a program is 4 to 5 years, really tracking roughly the tenure of a program manager. And what this means is that New Start programs actually comprise about a quarter of the total annual budget, or roughly $750 million per year. Now, these resources, combined with the talent and motivation of the program managers, really makes DARPA quite a potent developer of game-changing technologies. DARPA was formed in 1958 with the sole mission to prevent strategic surprise. Well, we figured out pretty quickly that we had to create surprise in order to prevent it. So you may ask, so what has DARPA created over its 60 years? Well, the first computer mouse, stealth for aircraft like the F-117. Miniaturization of GPS receiver electronics from large rack-mounted units into a package small enough to fit into your shirt pocket. Gallium arsenide semiconductor technology for very efficient RF power amplifiers, which help extend the battery life in our smartphones today. Advanced infrared imaging systems for giving us night vision. And about 10 years ago, the DARPA Grand Challenges, which played a very pivotal role in accelerating the development of self-driving vehicles using machine learning. Neural prosthetic limbs that restore reach and recently even touch. And then foundational technologies for Apple Siri, which were developed under a DARPA program called Personalized Assistant That Learns, or PAL, an admirable name, but nothing really like Siri. So it's evident that DARPA's technological surprises have certainly disrupted commercial markets as well as military tactics and strategies. Of course, we can't forget the internet. The world would certainly be very different today if DARPA in the late 1960s had not invested in making computers talk to each other as a network. This network grew slowly at the beginning. The first three nodes, actually, and you may be able to make it out, were in California. Number one being at UCLA, and number two at SRI, located really not too far south from here. In 1970, it reached the East Coast, and by 1981, there were about 200 host computers on the network, with a new host connecting roughly every 20 days. Well, of course, the rest now is history, with today over 40% of the world's population, or more than 3 billion people, possessing an internet connection. This exponential expansion of the internet and of cyberspace in general really has boosted our productivity to incredible heights, but has also opened avenues for bad behavior by a spectrum of threats ranging from individuals to nation states. And at DARPA, we are developing technologies to really help deter these threats. Well, three key concerns are often raised about cyber deterrence. The first concern really relates to the proverb, those who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. In other words, the dependence of the United States on a vulnerable cyber infrastructure could constrain our cyber deterrence actions. A second concern is that cyber attackers have so far been able to enjoy a very high degree of anonymity, which makes it difficult to identify and deter them. And the third is that if we do undertake a credible in-kind response to a cyber attack, we want our response to be accurate. So to address these concerns, we organize our cyber deterrence technologies into three areas, with objectives to one, strengthen the cyber resiliency of our networks and systems, which include cyber physical ones, such as the electric power grid. Two, achieve broad cyber situational awareness, which includes attribution of attackers. And three, create accurate and robust cyber response capabilities. So I will begin by describing a number of our programs representative of those strengthening cyber resiliency. So here's our friend, living pretty contently in his resilient glass house. Now, construction certainly plays a big role in resilience. And what I really want is to be able to construct things correctly from the beginning rather than fix them over a lengthy period of trial and error. So consider the purchase of my purchase of a hardened glass door for my glass house. I go to a store, I select a few doors. I like the one with stainless steel hinges, but I notice there's a crack in the glass at the lower hinge. So I ask, can you give me another one? Because I don't want a weakened door, and one without cracks or defects is brought quickly to me. Now, what if I was told that all doors made by that manufacturer come with a crack near one of the hinges, but the company will send me a patch in a week to fix it? And furthermore, there'll be new cracks appearing requiring additional patches. Well, I would guess most of you would find this answer unacceptable and look at doors made by a different manufacturer. Well, unfortunately, when we purchase software today, and I mention and emphasize all software, it comes with defects and vulnerabilities, and we accept a continual cycle of patching. So what we want to do, we really want to change this paradigm. And toward that end, we have a number of programs using formal methods to ensure that software is built as specified, that it is correct by construction. Software that does what it's specified to do and nothing else really helps tremendously in hardening it against cyber attack. We are developing tools and technologies for code construction using formal methods for embedded software such as that in a mission computer for a helicopter. In this particular case, we hardened the operating system and two control modules, but left unprotected the software for a camera module. We gave this unprotected software to a red team, challenged them to break out of it into the rest of the system. Now, we had formally proven that an attacker could not break out of this unprotected camera software. And indeed, the red team could not do so, certainly upholding the power of mathematics. Now, for those of you who are familiar with formal methods, you certainly are aware about the challenges associated with their scaling to larger, more complex software. Our program, Cyber Assured Systems Engineering, is really working to achieve the scaling through the composability of formally verified software modules. So once we have constructed something correctly, we really want it to last. So why can't software last as long as a well-constructed house? Modern-day software operates within a complex ecosystem of libraries, models, protocols, and devices. These ecosystems change over time in response to new technology, in repairing discovered vulnerabilities, or because of varying resource availability and reorganization of the underlying execution platform. Our building resource-adaptive software systems, or BRAS, really aims to address the need for long-lived, survivable, complex software systems that are robust with respect to changes in the physical and logical resources provided by the computational ecosystem. Such BRAS techniques, as the treatment of source code as a specification instead of as a program, will help facilitate the mapping of the code across a wide range of platforms. Now, if successful, BRAS can help mitigate high maintenance costs for software and premature obsolescence of otherwise functionally sound legacy software systems. Well, despite our best efforts to repel cyber attackers by hardening and adapting the software, these attackers do get in, and we want to use automation to engage them in machine time rather than human time. One program that really epitomizes this approach is the Cyber Grand Challenge, with the objective of automating what human hacker teams do in DEF CON's Capture the Flag competition, which is the world's certainly premier tournament for computer hackers. The automation developed by the challenge includes the discovery and patching of software vulnerabilities. Now, there were 7 final teams in the challenge, and what we see here in the chart are the 7 high-performance computing systems on which they placed the software that they developed for cyber reasoning systems that went head-to-head in the world's first machine versus machine cyber competition that was held at the beginning of DEF CON in 2016 in Las Vegas. It really was a great success. The first prize of $2 million was won by a startup from Carnegie Mellon University. The second prize of $1 million went to a team composed of the company Gramatech and a group from the University of Virginia. And third prize of $750,000 was won by a team from the University of California at Santa Barbara. A major highlight of the competition was that software flaws can last minutes instead of as long as years. For example, one of the cyber reasoning systems discovered a software vulnerability actually unknown to humans in one of the rounds of the competition, and then 3 rounds later, a second system uploaded a patch to this vulnerability, an elapsed time of 15 minutes. I can't emphasize enough how much this automation is a game changer for strengthening the cyber resiliency of software. So now, the Internet of Things, or IoT, is projected to grow to billions of devices. And by their low-cost nature, there are limitations of what can be done to protect these devices against cyber attack, example being the constraints on their memory and processing. Our Leveraging the Analog Domain for Security, or LADS program, is really striving to protect these devices. Now, you might recall that when software runs on computing hardware, that it can generate a collection of analog or physical signals, including electromagnetic emissions, acoustic emanations, power fluctuations, or thermal variations. The idea of LADS is that this collection of signals can be used to characterize the normal operating states of software. And then if there's a change in the software, say is due to some kind of malicious cyber attack, we should be able to detect this change by a change in the collection of analog signals and thereby cue a deeper investigation. Now, IoT devices will contribute to the generation of a lot more data. And over the next few years, global data generation is headed towards an astounding 44,000 exabytes, where an exabyte is a 1 followed by 18 zeros. Now, this is an astronomical number that makes it very difficult to get one's head around. But to help, I draw, you may be able to make it out, a thin white line on the rightmost circle. This white line is intended to represent just a few exabytes, which actually are considered equivalent to all the words ever spoken by humanity stored as text. So the enormous size of data today is really forcing us to rethink the approach of shipping data to some centralized data center for processing. 100 terabytes is just a small fraction of an exabyte. And its transfer, even at 100 megabits per second, would take about 100 days, which is too long, I would say, for most applications. We have a program called Dispersed Computing, which really seeks to take better advantage of the computing resources in a network, for example, the routers and even the base stations, for local data processing. We really want to provide the option of moving the processing to the data as well as moving the data to the processing. In essence, dispersed computing is really working to make the network itself a cloud. So given such massive data sets, many spurious correlations are inevitable, which underscores the importance of moving beyond correlation to causal explanation. And for example, there is a high correlation, 0.993, between the per capita consumption of margarine in the United States and the divorce rate in the state of Maine. Now, clearly, one's common sense says neither variable influence the other. So correlation is not sufficient for understanding. For humans, an explanation is needed before we feel we understand. So in addition to helping us avoid the pitfalls associated with correlative data analytics, we are also developing technologies to help ensure trust in the integrity and privacy of data, because this trust, we feel, is important to cyber resiliency. Consumer imaging products such as smartphones have become ubiquitous, and it is estimated that about 2 billion images and videos are uploaded daily to social media. Now, a growing proportion of this media has been manipulated, as really shown here in this chart. On the left, we see a manipulated image, and on the right, we are actually using detection of pixel-level inconsistencies to identify the manipulations. Now, most manipulations are benign, done for fun or for artistic value, but some are for adversarial purposes, such as propaganda or disinformation campaigns. The forensic tools used today to detect manipulations lack scalability and robustness and only address a few aspects of media authentication. An end-to-end system that provides a complete and automated forensic analysis does not exist. So we started the media forensics program, or metaphor program, to level the playing field, which currently favors the image manipulator, by the development of technologies for the automated assessment of the integrity of images and videos. So metaphor is helping us really try to build trust in data, and more specifically in visual media. So what about trust in the privacy of data? As indicated in this chart, we leave lasting data footprints in today's highly interconnected world. Now, although the ground here is really sand, I would argue that it's really more like concrete when it comes to our data footprints. We have a program named Brandeis that seeks to enable safe and predictable sharing of data in which privacy is preserved. The inspiration for the name of the program is Louis Brandeis, who wrote a seminal paper on the right to privacy early in his career before becoming a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The vision of the program is to A, maintain privacy, and B, tap the huge value of data. We really want to give the individual more control over their data through such technologies as differential data privacy and secure multi-party computation. If we leave a data footprint, we want to do so with the confidence that the data can be shared safely and predictably while preserving privacy. The potential impact of this program would be dramatic. Assured data privacy can help open the door to personal medicine as one notable example. So I hope I've given you a sense of what we're doing here to ensure trust in the integrity and privacy of data and to strengthen the cyber resiliency of software, devices, systems, and networks. And building on this foundation, let's now turn to programs developing technologies for situational awareness in support of cyber deterrence. So here we see our friend. He's now trying to find out who's been throwing the stones. And let me just take a moment to say a little about machine learning AI, as it is central to detecting and characterizing patterns associated with cyber threat behavior. I'll start with two familiar applications of machine learning, then a cautionary note on its use, and then finally, what we're doing to help build trust in machine learning. Well, two well-known consumer applications of machine learning are voice recognition by Siri on the left and face recognition by cameras on the right. And Siri actually was the direct result of a major investment in AI by DARPA over 10 years ago through a program I mentioned earlier called Personalized Assistant That Learns. Well, recognition based on machine learning is not foolproof. Here, the computer is wrong in describing the image of the child. The boy is not holding a baseball bat. Individual correctness is critical in certain situations, such as whether that person running towards you is carrying a weapon or a toothbrush. The Department of Defense certainly has concerns about these types of situations. Our explainable AI program is developing a new generation of machine learning techniques that are able to provide a rationale that explains conclusions reached by the system. So here, in this particular case, we see a conclusion that's been reached about that the image is one of a cat. But in addition to that conclusion, it provides an explanation as to why it thinks it's a cat. And we feel this is very important in terms of the use of these systems by human beings. If current trends continue, future autonomous systems will need to perform increasingly complex and sensitive missions, and machine learning AI will be a critical part of such systems. However, if developers, users, and senior leaders are to feel confident enough to deploy and use AI-aided systems, then these systems must be able to explain the rationale, and their recommendations, decisions, and actions must be delivered in a manner that human users understand and trust. Today, most machine learning systems provide no explanation, or the explanations they do provide is too detailed at the wrong level of abstraction. This program will develop the tools needed to build explainable AI systems. We have a program called Network Defense that is applying data analytics and machine learning to cyber situational awareness. The chart shows the results of a network defense analysis looking for unauthorized logins to a virtual private network. Cyber situational awareness includes detecting unauthorized logins to your computer, as well as your virtual private network or VPN. And toward that end, we launched a collaboration with an entity with a very large VPN, supporting about a terabyte of traffic per day, and generating logs and NetFlow for roughly 12 billion events per day. Now, in the chart, we analyzed logins over a period of a week, and at first, it looks pretty much like you'd expect, a distribution of logins over time, rising and falling with the working hours. But hidden in this seemingly normal mass of data, it turns out, was a single unauthorized IP address that successfully logged into 3,336 VPN accounts over 7 days, spanning, conveniently enough, the 4th of July. The activity associated with this address was buried close to under roughly 90 billion events. And so it would have a random chance of discovery about 1 in 10 to the 11th. So how did we find it? Well, we observed periodic login attempts starting on the 3rd of July that were spaced precisely 57 minutes apart. Now, there are people certainly with rigid schedules, but no one logs in exactly every 57 minutes. This anomalous behavior is a signature of an automated botnet. Well, we certainly recognize that the temporal patterns of botnets can range in sophistication, with pseudo-random behavior typical at the high end. This behavior is much harder to detect than a regular 57-minute periodicity. But using advanced algorithms applied to billions of network events, we have been successful in finding pseudo-random botnets. So it should be clear that the analysis of vast amounts of data can provide very useful insights. Even minimal data like NetFlow containing only the IP addresses of senders and receivers. Our success with network defense gives us hope that we can apply data analytics and machine learning to make it harder for a cyber attacker to remain anonymous. Our enhanced attribution program is addressing the cyber-deterrence concern of anonymity. This program aims to make transparent malicious cyber actions and individual cyber operator attribution through high fidelity visibility into many aspects of an attacker's activities. Our approach involves the correlation and fusion of data from a variety of sources, including commercial threat feeds, network IDS data, as well as NetFlow, to detect and characterize data tracks between an attacker and its target. This information can then be used to prepare a narrative for a convincing public attribution of a cyber attack. Now, there are other programs developing technologies for cyber situational awareness, but I'm going to turn now to a couple of programs that are working to create accurate and robust cyber response capabilities. So once we have found out who's been throwing the stones, we would like multiple options in regard to how we might, in an accurate way, deliver an in-kind response. Well, here's our friend who's actually doing a pretty darn good job in his response. So Plan X, it's a mission command platform for cyber operational planning and execution. In addition to providing a common operating picture of cyberspace, that extends from network topologies down to individual programs running on a given computer, it has developed a suite of automated tools For cyber operators who cannot be assumed to have degrees in computer science, electrical engineering, or related fields. These tools include the automated analysis of cyber courses of action. Third-party applications providing a range of capabilities can be accommodated through the Plan X App Store. And other notable features include laptop deployability and the ability to train while conducting operations. Malicious actors, shown here by the red dots, are currently able to compromise and use with impunity large numbers of third-party computers and other devices indicated by the gray dots. And as blue, we really want to counter red's actions in gray. And so these collections, such collections of conscripted devices, commonly referred to as botnets, are used for criminal, espionage, and computer network attack purposes, and often a combination of all three. Recent examples of botnets and similar malicious code include Mirai and WannaCry. The potential scale of their effects makes them a national security threat. Now, just improving the security posture of blue alone is really not sufficient to counter these threats, as the majority of the botnet nodes reside in neutral networks or gray space. Current approaches to dealing with these threats are really quite limited. And what we really want to do is be able to identify and neutralize botnets and other large-scale malware in conscripted devices, systems, and networks in a manner that's scalable, timely, safe, and reliable, and in accordance with legal and privacy guidelines. We started the HACS program to meet this need. In cyberspace, computers operate on nanosecond timelines with billions and even trillions of operations per second. In order to prevail in this space, humans cannot be in or on the loop, but must partner with machines that execute the loop under human supervision. This partnership or symbiosis is fundamental to the technologies we are developing to help empower US cyber deterrence, with the objectives, again, of one, to strengthen the cyber resiliency of our networks and systems, which include cyber physical ones, such as the electric power grid. Two, achieve broad cyber situational awareness, which includes attribution of attackers. And three, create accurate and robust cyber response capabilities. In parallel with these advances, we also are working to ensure the trust of the human in the machine, which includes trust in the data, trust in the software, and trust in the devices and systems, networks running the software. So this concludes the cyber deterrence part of my talk. What I would like to do is to wrap up, just give you, to change almost the subject, how we go about formulating our programs. And so the first step for a new program is to answer a series of questions first posed by the late George Hallmeyer, who was a former director of DARPA. So these are Hallmeyer's questions. Now, what most engineers and scientists who've got an idea, they like to start with the fourth bullet or the fourth question. You know, they're burning with excitement about their idea. And we understand that, but what we like to ask first is, okay, if you're successful, you know, you're wildly successful with your idea, really, what's the impact? And explain it in such a way that it's understandable. But really want to understand first what's the capabilities you'll deliver, what impact you have, who really cares? And if you really can't answer those questions, there's really no point in going further from a DARPA program point of view. And then if it is the case that it is impact there, then how's it done today? What's the current approaches? If other approaches throughout the world are on a track to meet this need, then we shouldn't pursue it further. But if it is falling short, now that's maybe worth now to now go into detail in terms of what is your idea itself. What are the risks, the technical challenges? What metrics or measures you're going to use to assess progress towards your goal? And then, of course, how much will it cost and how long will it take? And these, of course, I think we see not only at DARPA, but throughout the world in terms of how we go about trying to approach new concepts. Well, so RSA asked me to suggest how you might apply what you've learned today. And so came up with this process, which really centers on the Hallmeyer questions. So I would just recommend take a look at this, and if you think you have something there, and think about also submitting an idea to DARPA. So with that, that concludes my talk, and I'm happy to take questions. Yes.
When you guys first kind of went with the, you know, ARPA and the first kind of network, the internet, did you foresee any of what it's become? Did you think it was going to be a reality beyond that?
I would say no, given that it took decades to reach that. I can tell you, I wasn't there at DARPA. But no, but it is a valid question because I actually was at one of the grand challenges, and I, you know, that's 10 years ago. I had no idea where it would go today. And you know, actually all the individuals who competed in those challenges are all leading efforts, you know, in today's world, right, about self-driving vehicles. Very difficult to foresee. Yeah. Exciting though. Anything else? Sure.
Ah, yeah. The next 10 to 20 years coming along, have you seen anything that you think might make an impact like that that we can't discuss
here? Well, I'd love to say it would be out of my office, and I think we're doing great stuff, but I have to say, frankly, the work on neuroprosthetic limbs is very intriguing. And I know there's others in the world looking at it, but this is an exciting time in terms of as we have deeper understanding of the brain and the like. I think that's, I would put that one in a category that you're describing. Yeah, pleasure. And there's a one over. Yeah.
So one of your missions is to.
Oh, sorry. We'll catch you next.
So one of your missions was to support the Department of Defense.
Yes.
And with the global footprint of over 2 million people around the globe, all the different warfighting systems that they have, how do you see this Plan X scaling to defend against for aircraft carriers, for destroyers?
Well, Plan X is a mission command platform, so it should be applicable. What gets more challenging is the modernization of the software on all those systems. I would put that as a very challenging category. But what was interesting with Plan X, it originally was conceived as something at a much more strategic level, like cyber command. And what we have seen is the movement towards the so-called tactical edge, which is where we see all our embedded systems and the like. So I think it is moving in that direction. It comes down to, you know, what do the operators want to do in terms of being able to pull it in.
Yeah, I think the challenge is scale.
Sure.
And then we're talking warfighting systems, engage close proximity. How do you defend in the cyber domain when you have kinetic operations?
Yes.
Simultaneously.
Yes. Well, this is it. So. Sure. My pleasure. In the back, there was a question. Yes. Well, first of all, when we solicit ideas, we do it in as open a manner as we can. I mean, because we're really trying to tap the talent of the world. And we have cases where we can have a prime, and I'm using more government speak here now, but where someone, you know, will come in and as an international company. We see teaming where maybe like a university in the UK has decided to team with an American university. But it can happen. I would say it's much easier when you're looking at across the spectrum of science and technology, which is what DARPA does, that's its mission, is it's more on the basic research side becomes easier, let's put it that way, because of all the other considerations, export issues and the like. That gets more complicated. But we don't want to preclude that, so definitely. Yes, in the back. I think trying to understand better the brain, how we could help, and you know, let's say help learning along, That's, again, not in my office. It's in a sister office called Biological Technologies Office. Yes, there is those aspects of can we do better? It's not quite clear yet. I mean, but people, I think, it's again, we're just trying to understand, right? I hope people are hearing the questions. I'm not repeating them, but maybe that's okay. Anything else? Yes. Yes, I think we.
When will that happen?
When will that happen? When is another question. I won't go on the record saying when. But I think, you know, one thing is also understanding, you mentioned configurations. We actually are starting a new program, I didn't talk about it here, called configuration security. And when you start to assemble collections of devices or subsystems into a greater system, they all come with all these settings. Just look at your smartphone, right? And you can inadvertently leave open a path for an attacker just by misconfiguration of the system. The software can be perfect, right? So there's this, you know, ever expanding, but I think we're really definitely trying to address that aspect. I mean, the goal is not to put, see, all too often the paradigm is to put the burden on the user. And so, and then we get just, you know, constrained so terribly, what's the point, right? So we really want to shift that back, and how can we have technology in a trusted, reliable way be able to do it? Yeah. How's on time? 5 minutes. Okay, well, any other questions?
Any thoughts on quantum computing in the next 5 years?
There's certainly a lot of work going on. I think what I haven't seen, just me personally speaking, where's that real killer app beyond the Shor's algorithm, right? There's interesting work on, you know, if you use certain quantum computers as analog computers, can you map your problem to the lattice, like for example in the D-Wave system? So it's an area, I would say, of you know, rich basic research. So as a consequence, a little hard to say, you know, really how it come out. I mean, it's not to say, of course, Google and others are you know, looking hard at those systems, in addition, of course, to others. Yeah. Anything else? All right. Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure having a chance to talk to you.